I'm here to talk about fundamentally rethinking how we grow some of our most basic agricultural products, like meat and leather. Now, why is this an important problem? Well, it's an important problem because how we obtain our food has always been a cornerstone of how we live. If you go back more than 10,000 years ago, our ancestors, when population was a lot smaller, we only had in the low millions people on the planet, they were hunters and gatherers. They had to go to where the food was. And meat was very, very scarce. It was only available after a successful hunt, and it was distributed strictly based on status. It was not until the invention of agriculture and the domestication of animals that we finally were able to have permanent human settlements. And this greater food security and this abundance of calories allowed us to free up time. Time that we could use to develop trades, to create knowledge, pursue art, science, and lay the cornerstones of modern civilization. Now, fast forward to today, there have been tremendous advances in conventional agriculture and the distribution channels surrounding that that have enabled very, very high-value, high-nutrition items to be abundant, and convenient. So for example, meat, it's in most developed countries is widely available, it is affordable. It comes in very convenient form factors. You can grab it on the go, you can take it with you as you drive, and you can eat it at work. And this has supported not only the Industrial Revolution, not only urbanization, but it has also supported a tremendous growth in population over the last couple hundred years. I love meat. I'm a meat eater. And it was not until a few years ago that I really started thinking about the where it comes from and its true cost and its true limitations. And let me tell you why some of the numbers are really puzzling to me. Take a simple hamburger. To make a quarter pound hamburger requires nearly 7 pounds of grain, of feedstock, to produce that. And to irrigate that feedstock and to have the animal drink requires nearly 600 gallons of water just for that quarter pound hamburger. And that's the equivalent of showering for 6 weeks. So you can either have a hamburger or you can shower for a month and a half. To grow that feedstock and to allow grazing land for that animal requires about 75 square feet of land. And the energy that's required in growing the feedstock and transportation of the feedstock and of the animal is over 1,000 BTUs, which is about the equivalent of charging your smartphone 30 times. And perhaps most shockingly, the amount of greenhouse gases that are released throughout this entire process are about 13 pounds of CO2 equivalent in the form of CO2 and methane. And that is the equivalent of driving a car 25 miles. So take those numbers and multiply them by 1,000. And this gives you an impression of what the footprint is of a typical consumer per year. Because the average American eats over 220 pounds of meat per year. And if you look globally, today we have 7 billion people. And these 7 billion people are supported today by 60 billion land animals. It's more than ever before in our history. And over the next 30, 40 years, the global population is growing to 9 billion. And there's a greater wealth effect, primarily in emerging markets, that's driving greater and greater consumption of meat. So diets are shifting more to a Western diet. And so the demand for meat is expected to nearly double, which means that the demand for land animals is going to increase to be about 100 billion. So the problem here is that we're already hitting planetary resource limits. Today, 1/3 of all available ice-free land is used for livestock. It's used for grazing and growing feed crops for livestock. We're running out of land. 8% of the global water supply is used for the livestock industry. And 18%, by some estimates, 18% of greenhouse gases are attributed to the livestock industry. Some estimates actually place this higher, up to 50%. But either way you look at it, this livestock industry is the leading contributor to greenhouse gases ahead of any other sector, which means that we could get everything else right in terms of carbon abatement for transportation, For energy, we could be entirely clean in those sectors. And if we don't do anything about this, the effects here will more than offset gains there. And then add to this issues around food security, around disease risk, as we concentrate our herds. There's every year issues of outbreak of foot and mouth disease, E. coli, et cetera. And then the intensity of chemical use, chemicals, antibiotics, pesticides, to say nothing, of course, of animal welfare issues. Now, if we don't watch out, you know, some of the worst nightmare images from science fiction could become our environmental reality. But the big idea is, what if we could fundamentally rethink how we make animal products? If we could grow meat and leather in ways that don't require raising, slaughtering, and transporting animals. And if we can do that, it would require much less land, much less water, energy, and of course it wouldn't harm animals. Now, I'm going to tell you why this seemingly crazy idea is timely, why it is actually now technologically possible, and why it is actually not so crazy. This idea actually has a long history. Going back as far as the 1930s, Churchill himself wrote that if you think about it, the way we raise our animals is absurd. There should be a better way to do it if we grow only the parts that we need without having to actually raise, slaughter, and transport animals. And Churchill was way ahead of his time. But since then, there have been developments in biotechnology that have been very fundamental. There's been innovations in cell culture. There's been, over the last two decades, really big innovations in a field called regenerative medicine, tissue engineering. And the first company that I co-founded, Organovo, pioneered a form of tissue engineering known as bioprinting, where our goal essentially is to digitize how we grow tissue. And at the root of bioprinting, what we do is we take cell aggregates that are composed of tens of thousands of cells, and we organize them, we deposit them in layers, in patterns that then fuse together. So the cells actually start to behave exactly as they would in nature, where the processes of embryonic development take over, and the cells aggregates fuse together, and cells can sort out, and you're able to take these cell aggregates, and they can fuse together in pretty sophisticated ways. So you have an example, basically, of cell aggregates fusing together to form a sheet in the upper right hand. And in more complex structures, you can actually create things like branching vasculature, where you have cell aggregates that we've deposited that can fuse together to form a blood vessel, which is a multi-layer blood vessel composed of different types of cells. So we started to think to ourselves, well, gosh, if we can make, with Organovo, tissues that are to a very high medical pharmaceutical grade that pharmaceutical companies are using for drug testing and drug development that we're developing to meet therapeutic applications, to make textile and food-grade tissues is actually an easier problem. It's an engineering problem. The science has been significantly de-risked. If we can, in medical applications, make living tissues that are functional, if you think about leather and meat, they're no longer living, and they don't have to serve a biological function. And we also don't need to worry about issues of immune compatibility. So applied to meat, this is how our approach would work at a high level. You take the most perfect donor animal that lives a very happy life, and you take a biopsy of its muscle, of its fat for making meat, of its skin for the purposes of making leather, and you isolate the cells you need. So in the case of skin, it's fibroblasts. In the case of muscle, it's muscle cells, it's adipocytes, endothelial cells, et cetera. You isolate these cells, and you proliferate them in tissue culture medium. So you go from millions of cells that you have from the biopsy to billions of cells. And then you deposit them in a three-dimensional pattern in ways that they fuse together in two dimensions and then in three dimensions according to the processes that I told you about, bioprinting, form of biofabrication. And then we can actually, in the case of meat, perfectly marble it and get the right kind of fat in there. And then we grind it up in its first version, creating ground-up meat products like pâtés and sausages and deli products. With the right kind of nutritional content, better kind of fat, et cetera. And we've actually tried and tasted our own cooking. So 2 years ago at TetMed, our scientific founder and chief scientific officer, my father, Gabor Forgacs, actually unveiled a little pork chop that we had made without killing a pig. And he cooked it and ate it on stage. And I've also sampled our cooking last year. And we're both alive and well. And now we're working with some of the leading chefs in the US to perfect this into a delicious food item to get the mouthfeel, the texture, and the flavor right. And in the case of leather, I should say, I have a sample of leather here that I'd like to show you if you'd like to see. So one of the other advantages of this is it enables a degree of openness and transparency that has not really been possible in the food industry. It's unlikely that you'll gain easy access to a slaughterhouse. And if you do see an animal get killed and processed, it is unlikely that you're going to maintain your appetite and then want to go eat meat right afterwards. Whereas by contrast, the facilities that we would develop could be located in or near urban centers, so it would significantly shorten the supply chain. And they would operate like microbreweries, where the public could come in and visit and actually see how the sausage gets made and then sample the products right afterwards. Let's talk about cost for a moment. So over the last 40 years, the price of beef and pork have gone up 5 times. And if you project this forward for the next 40 years, because of the factors we've talked about, growing population, a growing wealth effect, and demand for meat, prices are going to go up non-linearly. Add to this the fact that these negative externalities, these negative environmental externalities, eventually will have to be priced in. And there's always pressure on government subsidies for these industries. So if you look at these potential factors, prices are inevitably going to go up for these materials, for beef, pork, and chicken. Overlay that with the cost of cultured meat. Today, it's pretty expensive. In our lab, it costs thousands of dollars to make a pound. But we're not operating at industrial scale. We're operating at a very, very small proof of concept scale right now. And we have specific ways that we forecast being able to reduce the price. So optimizing our cells, optimizing our medium, and being able to develop the processes and the hardware, the automation that allows us to really scale production, that allows us to get from thousands of dollars a pound to hundreds of dollars a pound and then below. And at that point, until you become cost competitive with beef, we are going to be a premium product. We're going to focus on high-value applications, for example, in leather and the fashion industry. And as we get better and better at producing this in volume and scaling this, we're going to become cost competitive with expensive kinds of meats and then eventually with more commodity-grade kinds of meats. So the long-term at-scale cost picture is also supported by these aggregate facts. A study out of Europe shows that cultured meat production would ultimately require 99% less land. It would require 96% less water. It would release 96% fewer greenhouse gases and require about half as much energy. So these steady state impacts really support a long-term cost perspective. So if we can get this technology right and if we can mainstream it, then it enables, supports a different positive vision from science fiction, one where we can locally grow on demand, cruelty-free, sustainably, abundant amounts of meat and leather in a way that can protect and preserve our future on this planet and potentially beyond. Thank you very much.